Is God in control? Now, I never dreamed that I would have to answer that question to Christians. But anyway, you know, that's what I've been learning since I've been a baby Christian. And somebody comes along and says God's not in control anymore.
So we have to discuss that. And the reason we're doing that is because we want God's people to be encouraged.
We want your faith to be strengthened. We don't want it to be torn down. Hello? And the Lord wants to give us the truth. We need to be established on the truth. The Bible is clear about that. Jesus said about his disciples, he asked the Father to sanctify them in the truth. And I know there's a spirit in the world today and in the church of where it seems like anything goes. Seems like, you know, it's all about oneness and unity and all that, and it really doesn't matter what you do or what you say. But we want to say that's categorically false. Amen? We are Christians are supposed to be united in the faith that was given to us by the Lord Jesus himself and by the apostles of our Lord. And what was passed on to us, Jude tells us we're to contend for it and we're to stand firm in it. And we're not to surrender it to some new doctrine or some new teaching. Amen? Because I tell you, all of those teachings are going to fail because they're not from the Bible. And they're going to produce bad fruit. And they're already producing bad fruit. But I won't get into that right now. So the second thing we're talking about is, will Christians take dominion? It's a big issue today in the church. Now, some of you, if you're new in the Lord, if you're young in the Lord, you may not know what any of these things mean. That's okay. It may seem to be a little bit complicated, but we're going to try and make it as simple as possible. But I guarantee you, you will learn something tonight. You will hear the truth of God's word, and there'll be an opportunity at the end for you to respond to him. Amen? Okay. So hang in there. We're going to talk about, tonight we're going to talk about, will Christians take dominion? And really what I'm going to do is talk about the millennium. And we'll explain all that in a moment. Tomorrow morning, we're going to do God is in control. And if you're doubting that God is in control, I think we will convince you tomorrow he's in control. Amen? And if we can't convince you, then he will convince you. You will find out he's in control. Then tomorrow afternoon will be the most comprehensive teaching on the rapture that you have ever heard. And I really mean that. We are going to go through the whole New Testament. We're going to show you the rapture in every book of the New Testament, except maybe one or two. And we're going to develop it, and we're going to teach on it, we're going to establish it, and we're going to answer questions. Amen? And I think it'll be greatly encouraging to your soul, greatly uplifting. So we're going to plow through some of the hard stuff tonight. And, you know, if you can hang in there for tomorrow afternoon, I think that's when you're going to really get encouraged and strengthened. But if you're only here for tonight, then you'll be encouraged by this message also. Okay, so let's talk about the millennium. What is the millennium? I'm not up there yet. Okay. What is the millennium? Well, the millennium is what we call the thousand-year reign of Christ. Millennium means a thousand, right? So it's the understanding that Jesus is coming back to the earth to establish his kingdom and reign for 1,000 years. Now, he's going to reign forever and ever, okay, ultimately. But the thousand-year reign is going to be on the earth. It's going to be with the nations, the remnant of the nations that have survived the tribulation period. And we're going to enter into a time where the glory of the Lord covers the earth like the waters cover the sea. Amen. And all the things we hear about and prophesy about are going to come to pass. All the words of the prophets the kingdom of Messiah will be established on the earth, and he will rule the nations.
Amen.
Amen? From Jerusalem.
Yes.
And Israel will be the chief nation, the priestly nation that she was called to be. So, you all heard me teach that stuff before, and I'm sure you've heard lots of teaching on it. But not too many people talk about the millennium. Now, and there's a reason for that. We'll look at that tonight. All right? Then when that 1,000 years are up, the Lord is going to start, Jesus is going to turn the kingdom over to the Father, and it's going to be the eternal state. There's going to be new heavens, new earth. There'll be no death anymore. There'll be no crying, sorrow, pain, anything like that. Amen? I don't know if there'll be any sheep. I think there'll be there somewhere. Amen. So we'll be the sheep. But God will have some sheep for Gordon. I know he will. Now, so let's establish this tonight in the Bible, throughout the Bible. It's in, you know, we could go through, it would take days to give you all the verses because it's a very large theme in the Bible. But we're going to start with 2 Samuel chapter 7. And this is God speaking to David. David had in his heart to build a house for the Lord, to build a temple for the Lord. And it was the Lord was pleased with David's heart, but he said that David would not be the one to build it. His son would build it. And of course, Solomon was a type of the Messiah. And the Messiah is the son of David. So Jesus is of the lineage of David. He's the son of David. And God made a promise to David that he was going to establish his throne. So let's read it. When your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your descendant after you, who will come from you, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, that was Solomon, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Now it jumps from Solomon to Jesus, because he is the son of David. Amen? He is the heir to the throne. He is God, but he's also man. And he is the one who is the kingdom has been given to and promised to forever and ever and ever and ever.
Amen?
Amen? Are you there? That's a reason to say amen right there. Your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established forever in accordance with all these words and all this vision Nathan spoke to David. Now, this is a promise from God that God is going to do this. Okay? It was not a conditional promise. There were conditional promises, but this one was God decided in his heart to establish the kingdom of David forever. Right? Think about this. And he put his name with this man. He connected his name with this man for all eternity. An amazing thing. Absolutely amazing. So Jesus is the son of David. Still today. All right, let's go to the next one. Then this is Isaiah chapter 9. For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders. You all know who that is? And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace. On the throne of David. See, we talk about the kingdom and the increase of his kingdom, but we never talk about David. We never talk about David. You know why? Because the church doesn't believe in David. The church, because of replacement theology, we don't talk about David. But nowhere has that promise been withdrawn. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore. How many of you know how long forevermore is?
Forevermore.
Any guesses?
Yeah.
Okay. The zeal, listen to it. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. God is not looking for any, depending on any man to get this done. This is a promise from Almighty God, and His zeal and His zeal alone will accomplish it. Amen? Now, this is Luke. We're in the New Testament now. We have just come from the Old Testament, and we're in the New Testament. And we see no change. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid," this is Mary, "for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus," or Yeshua in Hebrew. "He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And his kingdom will have no end." Amen? So, this is still a promise that is not yet fulfilled. He is reigning from heaven, so to speak, but kingdom of David is going to be established on the earth. Now, let's go to the words of Jesus himself. What did he teach us to do? He taught us to pray, and he taught us to pray daily, as we see in this passage. And you're all familiar with these words. Our Father, who is in heaven. I mean, we can preach a whole message on that, can't we? He's our Father. Hallowed or holy is your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, we get a lot of messages and preaching today on the second part of that. Your will be done, and we're told that we have to make that happen. But here, Jesus is telling us to pray for his kingdom to come. Look it up in the Greek. It means to come. That it's not here yet. It's here in us. We have received the kingdom. We have received the kingdom. No question about that. We have a foretaste of future glory. We have the presence of God. The kingdom of God is in us. But the kingdom of God has not yet come and has been established on the earth. Amen? I think if you just a casual look around, you will figure that out. This doesn't look like the kingdom of David. All right. So when they had come together, they were asked, this is the book of Acts. They were asking him, saying, "Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel?" Now, again, because of replacement theology, we look at these verses and we say, oh, they didn't have a clue, they didn't know. And that's how the church thinks. It's an arrogant attitude, really. And when I was a young Christian, that's how I was taught. Maybe that's how you were taught. But you have to remember, Jesus spent 40 days teaching the disciples after his resurrection. 40 days. A 40-day seminar on the kingdom of God, it says. And at the end of that seminar, they said, okay, Lord, is it now you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Because they were so excited. They didn't understand yet the whole idea of him going away. They didn't quite get that. Okay, they heard it, he told them, but you know how it is. You hear things, you know things, but you don't really grasp it till it happens. Right? And so Jesus did not in any way say, no, you guys, you missed the whole point. That's not what we're talking about. I think if that was the case, that would be the time to tell them. What do you think? But of course, they didn't hear him incorrectly. He is establishing, again, restoring the kingdom of David to Israel. To the Messiah is going to reign over the house of Jacob. Amen? So there's no break in this story. It goes right on through. There's no change in the plan. Are you there? Okay. Then I began to weep greatly. Then now we're in the book of Revelation. Chapter 5, verses 4 and 5. I began to weep greatly, this is John, because no one was found worthy to open the book or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, "Stop weeping. Behold, the lion that is from the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has overcome so as to open the book and its seven seals." So at the very end of the book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus is pictured as the king coming, the son of David, coming to rule and reign over the nations and establish his throne forever and ever. Amen? This is what we all believe. But we have divorced it from Israel. We've divorced it from its biblical context. We found a way to do that. It's called replacement theology. Does everybody know what that is? Okay. Replacement theology, it came about really, it began in the second century. By the fourth century, it became, it was crystallized and written about, and it became church doctrine. It became established. The whole idea that the Jews were rejected and the church took its place. Okay? This is what the early Christians began to believe. We're talking third, fourth century. They began to really preach this. And as well as that, there became in their hearts a hatred for the Jewish people. And to see them as Christ killers and just rejected by God and all kinds of crazy things they said about them. This is a fact of history. All right? And the reason for that is they, obviously, because of the Roman Empire, essentially, Constantine taking over the church, they saw themselves as beginning to rule and reign. So they began to recreate theology because Israel was scattered to the nations and the church was predominantly Gentile in makeup. And there were no Jews really around anymore, not very many. You understand? So this thing that Paul warned us about, not to be prideful or arrogant toward the Jews, is exactly what the church did. And the result of it has been that we lost our Bible. Oh yeah, we have it, and we read it, but we don't understand it. And we have so many people preaching different things from the same passages. Right? Am I right? And so we have not much, we have a lot of confusion, and people are just not able to talk about these subjects. But once we get rid of replacement theology, then the scriptures start to make sense again. And God is able to open our eyes and show us the true meaning behind them. And there is a literal meaning to the scriptures. Sometimes there are deeper meanings that God will show us, but the literal meaning is the one intended for us to know. That's the one that's coming to pass. Amen? Now, every prophecy about the kingdom of David that has been given up until the first century came to pass. Every single one of them, literally. Literally. There were over 300 specific prophecies about Jesus alone. What he was going to do. How he was going to enter Jerusalem on a donkey. How he was going to be sold for 30 pieces of silver. All the how his beard was going to be plucked out. How he was going to be crucified. It's laid out in detail in Psalm 22. And Isaiah 53. And so many prophecies that it just, there's no way they could be fulfilled unless God himself fulfilled them. And but the thing is this, every one of them was fulfilled literally. Okay?
Okay.
And then every prophecy about Israel has been fulfilled literally. So where do we get the right to suddenly, when we get up to 70 AD, we decide, oh, it's not literally or it's figurative. And see, that's been the big problem, right? But you see in these days, the Lord has brought Israel back from all the nations, and he has fulfilled the promises of the prophets, and the rest of what he has promised is about to be fulfilled. And that should give you great encouragement and great faith. To know that God is faithful to his promises. And if he's faithful to Israel, he's faithful to us. We know he's faithful. But this just encourages us all the more because we can see his faithfulness fleshed out in human history. Amen? All right. Next one now, Revelation 20, the very end of the book. Blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power. But they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Okay? So now we have established it right from the book of Samuel right on through to the end of Revelation. Okay? So the kingdom is literal. The kingdom is real. It is spiritual too, but it's not just spiritual. It is going to be established on the earth by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And he's the only one who can do it. Because he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And all dominion has been given to him. Amen? All right. How are we doing? What time are we finishing tonight, Kyle? What time did we say? Because I like to go by the time we said. Oh, we didn't say. Okay. Oh. We won't go too long. We won't tire you out. Put that there. Okay. Oh, we're going to read a few verses now. Is that all right? Just to show you, this is literal. I want you to see this literally. If it hasn't happened yet, it's going to happen. You understand? There are prophecies that have been prophesied that have not yet happened. But they're going to happen. You all look kind of not sure about that. Say amen or something. Amen. They're going to happen. Amen. Amen? Now, it will come about that in the last days, this is Isaiah chapter 2, the mountain of the house of the Lord, and one particular fellow, in fact, there's a lot of teaching today that this is the church. This is not the church. The church is not the mountain above all the mountains. Okay? The mountain of the house of the Lord, the temple, the mountain of the temple, that's the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, will be established as the chief of the mountains. It'll be raised up above the hills. That's physical, but it's also spiritual. It's going to become the capital of the world. Jerusalem has a call that no other city has, and that's why there's so much fighting about it, and that's why the enemy is dug in there and has to be evicted. Amen? And will be evicted. Amen? Okay. So don't be concerned, folks. God knows what he's doing. He's still sitting on the throne. Amen? He's on the throne. Yeah, the Irish comes back when I say throne. Throne, I don't know. Okay, whatever. All right, so has that happened yet?
No.
So what the church has done with it is made it the church and made it spiritual. And we've done that with all the good words. But if you go to the end of Isaiah chapter 2, it talks about what God is going to do, how he's going to judge the earth in righteousness. Men are going to be running into the caves and rocks saying, you know, fall on us and hide us from the wrath of him who is coming, from the wrath of the Lamb, just in case you have the wrong Jesus. Hello? Jesus is the Lamb, the wrath of the Lamb. Okay, we have this hippie Jesus going around today. And he could never do anything like that. That's what we're told. Watch out for that. Universalism is in the air and it's everywhere, which says there's no judgment, all that coming. But there is a judgment for the earth coming. Amen? We're going to go prove that to you. Now, come, let us, and it says, many peoples will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us concerning his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For the law will go forth from Zion, that's Jerusalem, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. That's a, what they call a Hebrew parallelism. They say the same thing twice, only with different words. The law will go forth from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. It's a technique to reinforce. And it's a good thing to know because Paul uses that kind of thing a lot. His writings are in Greek, but he thinks like a Hebrew. And he says things like that all the time. So it's very helpful to know. And he will judge between the nations and will render decisions for many peoples, and they will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. In other words, let me finish. Nation will not lift up sword against nation, and never again will they learn war. Now, has that happened? No way. Is it going to happen? Everything else in Isaiah happened literally, so this one is just figurative. See, this is, when you really grab a hold of this, you realize how we've been duped. How the enemy has led us astray. These wonderful promises, wonderful encouraging promises have been ripped off from us. And the one I quoted already, Habakkuk 2:14. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. This is the kingdom of David. This is the kingdom of Jesus. Yeshua, the Messiah, the Son of God and Son of David. Amen? Just a couple more. Now, this is the millennium we're talking about. The millennium. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth. And the former things will not be remembered now. New can be renewed as well as brand new. In this case, he's talking about renewed. We know that because of the rest of the passage. So when you keep it in context, it really makes all the difference when you keep it in context, doesn't it? The context tells us what whether it's brand new or renewed, made new. Okay? And how do I know that? Well, because he carries on. I will also rejoice in I will create Jerusalem for rejoicing and her people for gladness. I will also rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad in my people. And there will no longer be heard in her the voice of weeping and the voice of crying. Sound of crying. No longer will there be in it an infant who lives but a few days. Or an old man who does not live out his days. So there's still going to be death. That's how I know it's not the future new heavens and new earth, because there's not going to be any death there. You follow?
Yes.
So the context tells us this is the millennium, the reign of Messiah. And the youth will die at the age of 100, and the one who does not reach the age of 100 will be thought cursed. Oh my gosh, he's only a kid, and it's 100. What happened to him? Right? And the prophet is giving us this picture of what the millennium is going to be. Now, for those of us who know the Lord, we, of course, will be immortal, transformed into his image and likeness. This is not our condition. You follow? They will build houses and inhabit them. They will also plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They will not build and another inhabit. They will not plant and another eat. That's this picture of God's blessing on them, right? For as in the lifetime of a tree, so will the days of my people, and my chosen ones will wear out the work of their hands. They will not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they are the offspring of those blessed by the Lord, and their descendants with them. Okay. It will also come to pass, before they call, I will answer. And while they are still speaking, I will hear. Again, as the Lord's presence will be among them. The wolf and the lamb will graze together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. We always hear about the lion and the lamb, but it's actually a wolf and a lamb. And the dust will be the serpent's food, and they will do no evil or harm in all my holy mountain. Amen? Again, has that happened?
No.
No. It is to come. So when you're praying, thy kingdom come. This is what you're praying for. Okay? Thy kingdom come, Lord. Establish thy kingdom. Come. And it's a burden of our hearts. That's why we pray it every day. We should be praying this every day. Because in the Lord's Prayer, Jesus said, give us this day our daily bread. And one day I realized that if you're asking for daily bread, you have to do that every day. Oh, so he really wants us to pray every day. Amen? And to forgive every day and all that good stuff. But we should be crying out to God for his kingdom to come. Now, of course, we do bring the kingdom into the lives of other people, don't we? Because we have received the kingdom. And we can, all of you have received the kingdom if you've received Jesus. Amen? And the kingdom is in your life. And you can extend the kingdom to other people as they receive Jesus and come under his lordship and come into the kingdom. But the kingdom, as described in Scripture, isn't coming till Jesus comes. All right, I think we have, you believe me? I give you loads of verses, but it's up to you whether you believe them or not. You have to believe it. It's there, don't you? So if you don't believe it, you're going to have to find something else to do with it. And this, of course, is what the church has done. Now, we do, I need to say this, for past generations of saints, believers, who have looked into the Scriptures and pored over the Scriptures, some of these things were hidden to them, okay? They didn't have the kind of opportunities we have. They didn't have, Israel was not a nation. They didn't have Israel staring them in the face. They didn't have all the evidence that we have. You follow? So they had to go based on what they saw around them, what they believed God was doing, and what they believed, what they were taught, and all that, tradition, and all that stuff. So they had to deal with a lot of stuff. And we know that the Reformation, maybe you know what the Reformation is. I don't know if they even teach that anymore. But most of you are older, so you know about the Reformation. Amen? 500 years ago, Martin Luther, all those guys, right? They were used by God to restore the Scriptures to the people. What a great thing. That was the beginning of the restoration of the church. But it didn't stop there. And we have all these traditions who have camped out in every generation. They're still looking to Luther's teachings. The whole point of Luther was to go to the Bible. That was why Luther was raised up to give us a Bible. But we go back to Luther's teachings instead of the Bible. Are you there? So now, hundreds of years later, we have seen Israel established as a nation. We've seen it back in Jerusalem. We see the whole end time scenario setting up. So we have no excuse for not believing. Amen? And we have so much more insight than they had. So God will judge them based on their insight and what they knew. And the same will be true for us. Now, all millennialism is, how many of you heard that phrase? Most of you haven't heard these terms because leaders talk about them. They talk about them in schools and seminaries and stuff like that, but they never talk to God's people about them. I have found in my travels that when you talk to God's people, they believe the Bible every time. They'll go for the Bible. But the leaders have been schooled and taught in certain doctrines and philosophies, and so that's what they believe. Right? But when you talk to, when people read the Bible, they can never come to the conclusions that those guys reach. And this is the earliest one. It's called all millennialism, and that's the idea that there's no literal millennium. It's all figurative. And that there's no more Israel. Israel's done away with, right? That's the license for all the rest of it. The church is Israel. The kingdom is spiritual. Jesus is ruling from heaven. It's an indefinite period of time after which comes the eternal state, heaven and hell. So there's no millennium, really. That's what all millennial means. There's no millennium. Funny how they come up with that, isn't it? But understandable if you go back in history and see where they were at. All right? I'm just showing you the different positions now so you can understand which one is the right one. Millennialism is the belief that Christ returns after a period of time, but not necessarily a literal 1,000 years. Again, it's figurative, right? Built on replacement theology. Postmillennialism denotes the view that Christ will return after Christians have established the kingdom on this earth. Those who hold to postmillennialism believe that this world will become better and better, all the evidence to the contrary notwithstanding, with the entire world eventually becoming Christianized. That's the postmillennial view, and there are different variations of it. Okay? How are we doing so far? You're not bored or anything, are you? No? Okay. Good. Now, this is a term that is becoming popular today. It's a theology that was established in 1554 by a Jesuit priest named Louis de Alcazar. And 1554 to 1613. So he wrote this whole theology doctrine to counteract the Protestant Reformation. The Protestant Reformation was beginning to see the Pope as the Antichrist and all that kind of thing. And this priest came up with this whole system to counter that and to explain an opposing view. Okay? And what it means, a Latin word praetor, which means past. So this view says that all of the prophecies in the Bible about Israel, about the end of the age, all the words of Jesus about the end of the age, all of the book of Revelation, the book of Daniel, all was fulfilled in the first century in 70 AD. And when I was a young Christian, nobody believed that. Nobody believed that. Only one or two. I mean, it was like so small that we never bothered with it. Because, frankly, it's very hard to believe. And maybe there's somebody here who believes it, but I'm hoping I can convince you. I still love you, and Jesus still loves you, and we're still brothers if you believe it, okay? But you're missing the hope God has for you. And I want to give it to you. I believe this teaching is based on replacement theology. If you believe replacement theology, then you can believe this. But if you don't believe replacement theology, you cannot believe this. So that's where it stands or falls. Amen? Okay. So it's the view that all that is past, and it's essentially, it can be amillennial or postmillennial, but generally it's postmillennial, meaning that they're convinced that the church has to bring in the kingdom, establish the kingdom, take over the nations, and then Jesus can come. Until then, Jesus can't come. Even if he wants to, he can't come. He's waiting. He's depending on us. Right? But Jesus was quite clear that he's coming when he's ready. He warned us over and over and over again, be ready. Be alert. Be ready. Amen? We're going to see that tomorrow. The warnings are phenomenal. And then for us to come around and say, well, when we're ready, you can come. What a twist. What a distortion of Scripture. Now, the reason we're talking about this position is that it's becoming more and more prevalent today. There are many, many people teaching it now, and it's working its way into the so-called mainstream. So we need to talk about it, and you need to understand, so you can be clear on what people are teaching. Because they don't tell you what they're teaching. I just want you to know that. They don't get up and say, I'm a preterist, so here's my teaching. They teach it to you without telling you what they believe. And you think, well, that sounds really good. You don't know. And then years later, after you've swallowed the whole thing, you find out what it is. How many of you know that's true? I think that's, well, as they say, disingenuous. Because you need to tell people up front what you believe. You're going to have them commit to some system of theology that they don't know what it is. All right. And the one that's the common one, I should have said this already, is partial preterism. Now, the full preterists believe that everything happened in the first century, everything, including the resurrection, Jesus coming, the judgment, everything. There's nothing left to happen except for us to take over the earth and everything's going to get better. That's the full preterism. Full preterism is absolute heresy because it goes against the foundations of the faith. The rapture has happened. I'm not the rapture. I don't believe in the rapture, but the resurrection has happened, first and last, and that Jesus has come in glory in the clouds of heaven, and all that happened in 70 AD or thereabouts. There's no tribulation, no anything coming for them, no judgment. And this is what we really have to be warned about, because the goal, the ultimate conclusion of all these teachings today is that there's no judgment coming. Right? And this is what's so deceptive about it, because there is a judgment coming, and we're at the time where it's almost ready to come. Amen. And so, isn't it just like the enemy to stir up this teaching so everybody's not believing it's coming anymore? For thousands of years, the church believed it was coming, and now it's not coming. Okay. They call it victorious eschatology. And this man, bless him, he's dead now, but I'm going to read what he said because it's still the clearest. See, Peter Wagner is one of the clearest expressions. At least he was honest. He said what he believed. Victorious eschatology makes a convincing argument that the biblical prophecies concerning the last days or the end times were literally fulfilled at the time of the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. The end times marks the ending of the old covenant and the beginning of the new covenant. Jesus literally will return to the earth in the future, but none of the signs of Matthew 24, 4-34 are expected to precede his return because they've already occurred. This is known by professional, underline that word, theologians. Professional is a word that bothers me anyway, especially when it comes to the things of God. How can we be professionals? As the partial preterist view of eschatology, and it is the view with which I personally identify. So at least he told everybody what he believed, but most people didn't even hear it. They just kept right on going, right? So partial preterism is different than full preterism to the degree that they believe in the last two chapters of the book of Revelation. That's it. All the rest of it's already been fulfilled, right? So they still believe that Jesus is coming to judge individuals and to bring the final resurrection. Okay? But the problem, there are many, many problems. But they believe that when Jesus said he would come through the clouds with power and great glory, that happened in 70 AD. They believe the first resurrection happened in 70 AD, and it was spiritual, people getting saved and born again. That's the first resurrection. Now, there are different variations of it, so maybe yours was a little different, but it's essentially, you have to believe that, because if you believe the millennium, that you're bringing in the millennium, then you have to believe the first resurrection has happened, because the Bible is clear in Revelation 20 and 21 that the resurrection before the millennium and a resurrection after it. Okay? So you have to believe that the first one has happened. And what they do is they spiritualize it. So isn't that very encouraging? All the promises of God already happened and you missed the whole thing. You don't seem too excited. All right, these are books that are out on the subject. I just want to let you know these are preterist, partial preterist books. That's what they believe. You need to know. I can save you a lot of work. They call it today victorious eschatology. And the church fell into this, and I remember when this all started, because I've been around a while. So I remember in the late 70s, early 80s, and I believe rightfully so, we believe the church is victorious. I still believe in a victorious church at the end of the age. We call them the overcomers. The bride of Christ, the overcomers. I do not believe in a church defeated at the end of the age. Okay? But I believe God's version of what overcoming is different than what the church is now teaching. And we can get into that tomorrow if you want. But, so that's what they're calling it. And these two books, I've examined them. This is the standard one, Victorious Eschatology, that they're all following, by a guy named Harold Eberle. And this one here essentially denigrates the rapture and premillennialism and presents the partial preterist view. I haven't talked about premillennialism yet, so some of you don't know what that is. There's a lot of big words here. Okay, these are some of the books that are out there. Raptureless, Christian Hope Fulfilled Prophecy, and it's an exposition of evangelical preterism. I just want to show you that this stuff is real. I'm not making it up. These are some of the people. Now, John Eckhart, have many of you heard of him? He is a full preterist. I mean, full. Both resurrections, everything has already happened. He is, in my opinion, outside of the creeds of the church, outside the Apostles' Creed, and I consider that full-blown heresy. And yet, to this day, not a single person has called him on. He has books, like rooms full of books, and they advertise them everywhere, and he's on all the major programs and everything else. And this is the condition the church is in. Nobody confronts anything. If you confront anything, you're divisive, and you're not loving, and you're legalistic, and all these names. But I'm sorry. If we're going to stand before Christ, and we're going to give an account for the way we've lived, and if we let our brothers go off into error, and we don't have the courage or the love to confront them, then shame on us. God will rebuke us. Amen? I'm not saying that, you know, we have to be mean or, you know, we don't have to be like that. We would speak the truth in love. But there's nothing wrong. I have to mention the name. Why? So why do you mention names? Well, because people today do not get it if you don't mention the name. They say, oh, well, I never heard that. Or my pastor doesn't believe that, and I know he does, but they don't know he does. And if I don't mention the name and show them where he does, they will never know. You follow? Because he won't get up and tell them he believes it. He just will never talk about it. He will never talk about the coming of Christ. He will never talk about any of those things. And if a church is not talking about any of those things, there's a very good chance that they're partial preterists. Okay, and here's another one. I'm just going to read what Cal Pierce had to say. Christians who follow on the focus on the harvest don't really have much time to worry about a rapture. Their goal is to get as many people into the kingdom as possible in preparation for the wedding. And here's the now. Up until this point, he hasn't indicated he's a partial preterist. Okay? But you see, when you know the words, a victorious eschatology, see, that's the buzzword that tells me he's a partial preterist, will put a rapture mindset behind and a harvest work before you. So the point here, and trust me on this, I've done my homework. And again, I'm not saying anything about him as a person, but he's very popular. And the people who follow these guys don't know what they teach. But some of it is their own fault because they don't read. This stuff is all over the internet. Amen? So there's no excuse for, you know, not reading the Bible, not reading stuff, and not being alert. Didn't Jesus warn us to be alert? Here's another guy. Now, the only names I'm going to mention, and then I'm going to go back to the teaching. But I have to show you that this stuff is real, and it's in our circles. And many of the people that you maybe follow are teaching it, and you don't know. Right? So you need to decide. That's up to you. I can't make that decision for you. If you embrace that teaching, fine. But if you are a premillennialist, which I'll explain in a minute, and you don't know that that's what these people are teaching, you're being deceived. Hello? Who wants to be deceived? Jesus said that if it's possible to deceive you, you'll be deceived in the last days. Did he not? Okay. For too long now, the church has been riddled with fear because of bad theology and misinterpretation of Scripture as it relates to end time theology. History alone backs up what took place in 70 AD, see, with the destruction of the temple and the end of animal sacrifices. Well, we know that happened. This was the undisputed historical view of all of our forefathers and theologians until the dawn of the 20th century. See, that's false. That's absolutely false. I can prove to you that that is not the view of the early church, nor is it the view of the early church fathers. So that is absolutely false. It's time for a clear picture to emerge within the church that biblically and historically energizes her with a glorious eschatology. That's another buzzword. We are to think long range and bring revival to the nations that will transform the earth. See, that's his theology. Now, fine, state your theology, then people can choose, right? Nothing about him as a person. I'm not saying anything about him. He's probably a great guy. I'm sure he loves the Lord. You follow what I'm saying? But you need to know these things. And when I stand before Jesus, I won't have to hear him say, "Why didn't you warn my people?" And maybe I can, you know, Jude told us to snatch some of them from the fire. I believe this theology is very dangerous because the end time scenario is happening. It is coming. And these folks are going to misinterpret it. And they're going to be on the wrong team. Because peace and all that's going to be talked about, and they're going to fall into that because that's what they believe. All right, enough of that? Enough of that. Okay, I have an article. Where's Kyle? There. What does that mean? Okay. We'll go a little longer, okay, and then we'll close in prayer, all right? How are you all doing? You all right? I don't want to wear you out. Okay. Line is young, Jeff says. All right. I have an article. It's on my website, and it's also in the back of one of those books. It is 12 reasons why partial preterism is false. Perhaps I should go through that now. What do you say? Hey, it came up. Look at that. But you don't have it. So, Kyle, how do I get it over there? Do I go over there and click on it? Does that work? Probably not. I have it right here on my screen. I just need to put it on the... He's good. He'll do it. Oh, yeah, drag it over. Get out of that. Maybe it's the time to just stand up and stretch. A bathroom break, if you need to go to the bathroom. Amen? He's got it. Okay. Well, you didn't take advantage of it, so now you don't get it. Okay. The first reason? Yeah. It's up there, but I don't have it. So we'll go over here. All right. I guess we just pull it up. Is that it? All right. So the first one I have on here called what I call apostolic eschatology. The eschatology of the early church, the eschatology of the apostles, which we're going to talk about tomorrow. Amen? Preterism is the view that all of the prophecies concerning the end of the age occurred in 70 AD and there's no end time events on the horizon. All right, I said all already. The first reason, preterism is built on replacement theology. We've clearly stated that. And all of the prophecies about Israel are essentially taken over by the church, all the good ones. And they don't come to pass literally. So there's a huge problem there because up until 70 AD, everything came to pass literally. So who has the right to change that? And we know from history that they're still happening. Right? And there's certainly from this generation, in the last 100 years, we are seeing them being fulfilled. So you have to deny what's happening around you. You have to deny what the Bible promised about all of the prophecies promised that God would restore Israel at the end of the age and bring them back from all the nations. And that has happened. So you have to deny that, which I think is impossible to do, really, if you're honest with yourself. Now, if you don't know that, perhaps nobody's ever told you, but this is an incredible miracle that has happened and has been prophesied by all of the prophets. Amen? Okay. I'm not going to read everything, obviously. But you can get this article online. It's on my webpage. It's understandingbibleprophecy.org. In response to the question as to what was the sign of the end of the age, Jesus said it was the abomination of desolation mentioned in Daniel. Right? This was confirmed by Paul as the occasion when the Antichrist literally sits in the holy place in Jerusalem and proclaims himself God. Fact is, that has not happened. It wasn't, they say it's Nero. It was no way was it Nero. All he did was fiddle in Rome. He didn't do anything in Jerusalem. You know, I mean, we have to pull things and we have to stretch things and we have to create all these scenarios to try to make this work. And it doesn't work. And they admit it doesn't work. So then they try to pull some of it from 135 AD to kind of finish it off. But none of it works. This is a literal event. Jesus said, Paul said, Daniel said, and they point us to Daniel, said that this man of lawlessness will be revealed at the end of the age. We know him as the Antichrist. And John said, there are many Antichrists that have gone out, but he affirmed the Antichrist is coming.
Okay?
And so the Antichrist has not come.
And how can you say, looking over 2,000 years of history, that Nero was worse than Hitler?
Nero was the Antichrist, but Hitler isn't. So who is the Antichrist? And the prophecies all indicate clearly that after that event, the kingdom comes. And they believe the kingdom has come. So what has happened? And by the way, the devil was bound 70 AD. Does it seem like he's bound to you? Thrown in a dungeon. I think he's quite active. If this is as far as we get without the devil, I really don't have much excitement. But you see how foolish these things can be when you really examine, right? But they sound good, and people don't ask questions. Because who am I to ask a question? Because this guy's Bible teacher, and he's well known and very famous, so people are intimidated. They feel like, I can't ask a question. I can't do anything, right? But don't be intimidated. But don't be unloving either. I warn you about that. There's lots of people pointing out this stuff, and they're very unloving. And they don't believe in the Holy Spirit, which to me is total heresy also. Well, they believe in the Holy Spirit, but they don't believe in his presence and power in our lives. They believe all that ended in the first century. That's a problem. So what's the good if you figure out all the other deception, but then there's a big one over here and you swallow it? How many poisons does it take to kill you? You know, only one. Right? So don't fall for that one either. Just believe the Bible as it's been written. Amen? Literally. Believe it. And where it's not literal, it tells you. It will always tell you. All right. Come on now. I was doing so good, too. Okay. The tribulation is described by Jesus as a time of such distress that there was never anything like it before, nor will there be again. He said that if it had not been cut short, no life would have been saved. Now, we're supposed to believe that the Romans surrounding Jerusalem and destroying the temple and scattering the Jewish people was that event. And the world went on, and much of the world didn't even know about it. No, this is an event that Jesus said, like, has never happened before. And of course, that blows that out of the water, because many things worse than the skin. Now, of course, if, for the Jewish people, that was the worst, right? But for the nations, there have been much more. World War I and World War II, for example. How do you explain that? All right, so if that was the event in 70 AD, then how come Jesus said there never would be another one like it, and we've had two massive world wars that have never been seen anything like before? You get my point? Okay, I'm glad you're listening. Number four, Jesus said that there would be great signs at the end of the age, such as the sun becoming dark and the moon red blood. And it's not an eclipse, by the way, because everybody knows what they are. Even from ancient times, they've known what eclipses are. So that's not going to scare anybody. But this is actually the lights going out. This is another event altogether, and it's going to last for a while. And the sun become dark and the moon red blood, stars falling from the sky. Stars. Now, we know they're not stars literally. You say, oh, here you go, you're not literal. Well, there are literal objects coming from the sky that look like stars, and the prophets would have seen them as stars, and we would call them stars too. Okay? We even say, oh, that's a shooting star, a falling star. They're objects, meteorites or asteroids that are coming out of the sky and hitting the ocean, hitting the earth, causing catastrophic. Okay? You want to be around for that? You like that? Like that stuff? Okay. Now, the next, has that happened? So it's future. It, according to Jesus, happens at the end of the tribulation. Matthew 24, verse 29, I believe. Number five. According to partial preterists, Jesus came in the clouds in 70 AD, pouring out wrath upon the Jews. If that were true, it would fulfill the following passages. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn. When did that happen in 70 AD? And they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. And it says they will see, and yet nobody saw it. In fact, they have to go into the writings of Josephus to find a little hint that somebody saw something. Okay? And it's just a speculation from Josephus. Maybe he heard somebody say they saw, like they saw chariots or something. Have you heard that? No, yeah, that's the fulfillment of, no, nonsense. The whole world is going to see this. Every eye will see him, Jesus said, right? When he comes through the clouds. And then it says he will blow a great trumpet and gather his elect from the four winds. And by the way, that's the Jews. I know you're not going to like that, but that the elect in all those passages in Matthew 24 is the Jewish people. There were no Gentiles in the kingdom at that point. None, nor would his followers, who are all Jews, know anything about that. Okay? Now, are we elect? Yes, we're elect. We're chosen by God. We're chosen as the bride of Messiah. We're given that option. We're given that choice if we want to be the bride of Christ. Amen? So we have a great and high calling, and I'm not in any way diminishing that. That's another whole day we could spend on that. Are you there? But these are Jews, because he said, remember he said, if this time had not been cut short, no life would be saved. And but for the sake of the elect, the days will be cut short. Now, you know how I know that's not Christians? First, I gave you the fact that they were all Jews, and that was their understanding. But number two, there's no benefit to the enemy by killing Christians. If he wipes out all the Christians, we come back with Jesus anyway, so he doesn't get anywhere. He doesn't nullify any of God's promises by killing us. Do you understand? But if he could wipe out the Jewish people, then he would nullify the promises of God. And that's been a strategy of the enemy for centuries. That's what the so-called final solution was all about. And it's in the hearts of the nations again today. That alone should tell you something. There's a demonic strategy behind that. But God is, this time, God is going to fight them personally. The Bible says he's going to come out of his place. Isaiah chapter 2, as we were looking at before. Isaiah 24 says the earth is going to rock to and fro like a drunkard. Have you seen that yet? No, I'm not looking. No, you don't want to be here for that, trust me. That's bad. Okay, all right. And here, this passage here also, which is the same passage. I saw heaven open, behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. You know the passage, right? And it ends with this great supper of God when all the armies are given over to the birds and so on. And this is supposed to have happened in 70 AD. It didn't. There's no way it happened. Okay? That's still future. Amen? If that happened in 70 AD, what a letdown. If I got your attention here, what a letdown. If this is the millennium, what a letdown. I was expecting something better than this, were you? But thank God. Thank God. That's wrong. Amen? The promises of God are yes and amen. They are coming to pass right before our eyes. Amen. So, a couple more, okay? I said there were 12. And then we can stop at the end of this. How's that? Number 6. Oh, I want to add to that. And there, that verse as well has to be fulfilled because they believe every book, every chapter in Revelation up to chapter 20 has been fulfilled. And so this one also. Behold, he's coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him. And even those who pierced him. So where have the Jews seen the Messiah and repented and turned to God? Well, see, they don't care about the Jews. So they don't care about this passage either. They've translated it or, you know, interpreted it for something else. You follow? And here's another little anti-Semite thing that's going on. How come the Jews got all the punishment, got all the judgment, and the Gentiles aren't getting any? Do you ever wonder about that? Oh, they if you read the books, it was all poured out on the Jews because of their rebellion. And we've been so good. After 2,000 years of the church, it's been so good, right? Go back and read history. Now, if I thank God that the church is revived and it's being restored to its biblical place. I believe that we're coming into the fullness in these days of what the Lord has promised. We're not there yet, but we're coming into it. Amen? And one of the things we have to reclaim is the Word of God. We need a revival of the Word of God among the people. I was recently with a well-known revivalist. I won't mention his name. Well-known. And he looked me in the face and he said, what we need is a revival of the Word of God. I said, I felt like saying, I told you so. But I didn't. I bit my tongue. And he said, yes, that's what we believe is coming. To where we get the Scriptures back and we hold on to the faith that is once and for all delivered to the saints, as well as the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, because that's part of our faith. Amen? He said he would be with us always, even to the end of the age. That's not figurative. That's literal. You can't have it both ways. You can't say, oh, that's figurative. That's literal, but that's figurative, because you don't like that one. Absolutely. Okay, let's go on. Number six, Jesus said that the end of the age would be like the days of Noah. Was the first century like the days of Noah? The implication is clear, that people would be evil and clueless of the judgment that was coming. Then suddenly it came upon them and they perished, but a remnant was delivered. Did that happen in the first century? No. Are you with me so far? And of course, there's a seventh. There's always a number seven. Right, Jim? You have to have seven. The Bible promises a bodily resurrection at the end of this age. A bodily resurrection. I'll give you the scriptures on it there. Okay? That's Revelation 20. And also, if you go to Daniel chapter 12, Daniel is told to go his way till the end of the age, and then he would be resurrected. Right? And the Jews have known for the longest time, in ancient times, they were taught and understood that on the last day, the resurrection would come. You remember what Mary and Martha were saying to Jesus? We know that he will be resurrected on the last day, meaning the day of the Lord. Right? But we'd like him now, if you don't mind. That's what, sort of what they said. Lord, could you do something about it now? And you know the story, right? How Jesus raised him up. But they were taught. They didn't have to ask the question. They were taught that. They understood. They all understood what the last day was about. The end of the age. Amen? So we have to believe all the Old Testament, all the Old Covenant saints were resurrected in 70 AD. We missed it. Okay. Oh, no, somebody said. All right. Oh, there's another one. There's 12, right. Sorry about that. The Hebrew believers were told that Jesus would come again for them without reference to sin. They were also told that they could see the day approaching. Since preterists say that Jesus came in 70 AD in judgment and not without reference to sin, when were these verses fulfilled? And how could they both be fulfilled in the future since there is no day of the Lord approaching and no signs? Number nine, preterism depends on an early date for the book of Revelation. It has to have that. But the best sources we have say it was written 95 AD. John was an old man. And Domitian was the emperor. And we get that from the writing of Irenaeus. And Polycarp, who was a disciple of John, and Irenaeus, who was a disciple of Polycarp, has that written down very clearly. And so have some other sources. So again, it's dodgy. We have to erase the writings of somebody who is very close to the apostles, who recorded it, and other sources as well, and just decide to believe that in the 60s, not the 1960s, but in the 60s AD, okay, that John got the book of Revelation then, when he was much younger. And there's so many questions about that. Where was the rest of the church? Why is Jerusalem not mentioned? All that. If this was before the destruction of the temple, why is the church in Jerusalem not mentioned anywhere in the book of Revelation? It's only the churches in Asia Minor. So there's many questions like that, right? Okay, next one. The events described by Paul and referred to as the day of the Lord included the coming of Jesus for the church in the rapture. We know this in 1 Thessalonians 4:17. Okay, and it was to be at the time of the abomination of desolation. Therefore, why did the rapture of believers not occur in 70 AD? It didn't. Most of them were. The Jews, the apostles were all murdered prior to that. And the rest were scattered out of Jerusalem. We know of no rapture that took place. So if I believe that it was all fulfilled in 70 AD, then the rapture was a false promise. But it's not. Amen? All right. Number 12, Peter, speaking of the day of the Lord, said the following: But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. Did that happen in 70 AD? No. Amen. Okay, let's just stand up now. And I'm done. I was going to go further, but time has eluded me. Amen. So the Lord is coming, folks. He's coming for those who love him. I maybe want to hear that message tomorrow. If you're around, please come.